Hello, coders. So back in this previous video, I first showed the light transport equation and explained how we often rely on lighting models which only approximate the light transport equation, but are simpler to calculate and map well to graphics hardware. So far, we've covered the Lambertian model, also known as diffuse shading. It makes the assumption that the surface reflects incoming light equally in all directions. This is a very basic model that works well for non-metallic matte surfaces. The Blinn Phong model builds upon the diffuse shading model by also supporting shiny materials. Shiny materials tend to reflect light more strongly in the direction opposite the angle of incidence. This is known as specular reflection. A mirror, for example, would be a perfect specular reflector, while smooth surfaces like metal and plastic are less perfect, but specular lighting still has a noticeable effect on their appearance. A reason for these differences are microfacets on the surface of the material. These microscopic bumps and grooves cause slight deflections in the reflected light rays. Smooth surfaces will reflect the light more ideally, with the reflected light being strongly concentrated around the theoretical ray of reflection. With rougher surfaces, the reflected light can be scattered in more possible directions, resulting in a less concentrated cone of reflection. The key difference between this and the Lambertian model is now the position of the viewer actually matters. With the Lambertian model, we assume light is scattered equally in all directions, meaning that regardless of the camera position, the point on the material will look the same. With the Blinn Phong model, the light intensity is greatest the closer the viewer is to the theoretical ray of reflection for each fragment. In many cases, none of the reflected light will reach the viewer. You should already have a natural intuition about this. It's the reason why when looking at a shiny material, the location of the highlight changes as you move around. There are a handful of models that try to approximate specular lighting, each with their own pros and cons. I'm not going to delve into too much detail as to their differences. For a detailed look, check out this resource here. A Gaussian model can more accurately approximate the microfacet distributions different materials may have. Both Phong and Blinn Phong models don't use a real statistical distribution and kind of just make things up. This means they violate things like conservation of energy, however they require less computation and look good enough for our purposes currently. Also, we will implement physically based lighting for rendering materials more realistically in the future, so the Gaussian model just isn't necessary for us right now. So how exactly do these models work? Well, the main idea behind the Phong model is we calculate the dot product between the ray of reflection and the direction to the viewer. The dot product is a nice function for this because it is a measure of the angle between two vectors when normalized. The dot product result varies from 0 when perpendicular to 1 when parallel. Negative values will be ignored. Next, we take this result and raise it to some power. The parameter here affects the sharpness of the highlight. For example, a brushed metallic material may use a value of 32, while a smooth metallic material would have a much higher value of like 512. These values are somewhat arbitrary since they don't correspond to any physically based model. So our inputs to the power function will always be between 0 and 1, meaning that the output range will be between 0 and 1 as well. A higher exponent more quickly crushes lower values to 0. Resulting in a smaller region where the specular component is bright, hence the sharper highlight. As the final step, we combine the diffuse and specular components together to determine the final color for each fragment. The Phong model has some limitations. Most notably is that the angle between the direction to the viewer and ray of reflection must be less than 90 degrees for the specular component to be non-zero. For smooth materials with a sharp highlight and a high exponent, this isn't much of an issue, since the specular light should be very concentrated. However, for rougher materials, it should be possible that a non-insignificant amount of specular light is being reflected to the viewer at an angle surpassing 90 degrees, which the Phong model alone doesn't really account for. The Blinn Phong model, on the other hand, overcomes this limitation by first calculating the vector directly between the direction to the light source and the direction to the viewer. This is known as the half-angle vector, which can then be compared with the surface normal to determine the specular intensity. When the direction to the viewer is perfectly aligned with the ray of reflection, the half-angle will be perfectly aligned with the surface normal. which is the same behavior as the Phong model, but the angle between the half angle and the normal will always be less than 90 degrees, which avoids the main limitation of the Phong model, where it can't account for angles larger than 90 degrees. One last addition that is commonly made is to add a control term to configure the strength and color of the highlight based on the material. This is an RGB term that is multiplied by the light color and specular light intensity prior to combining with the diffuse component. Most often, it is useful to make this a neutral value less than 1. However, for some materials such as gold and other metals, this term can be set to the material color because highlights on metal can take on the surface color. Anyway, let's get to coding. The first thing we're going to do is update the global UBO struct within the frame info header, as now we will need to access the camera's position. Rather than directly pass in the camera's position, I'm actually going to provide the inverse view matrix. Using the inverse view matrix, the camera's position can easily be extracted from the last column. Additionally, if ever in the future we need to transform a value from camera to world space, we will have that functionality ready to go. Next, we need to add the inverse view matrix calculation to the camera class. In the camera header, I'll declare and initialize a 4x4 inverse view matrix field to store the result. Then, in the camera's implementation, we currently have two functions which update the view matrix, with the idea being that whenever the view matrix is updated, the inverse view matrix should be updated as well. And because their construction is so similar, no extra calculations are really needed to be done. I've provided a pastebin link in the description below. The only differences are the upper 3x3 position is transposed, and the final column is now simply just the position. This should make sense, since another way to think about the inverse view matrix is as the equivalent to the model matrix for the viewer game object. Really, we could have just used that instead. Next, in the setView YXZ function, we should also paste in the code to set the inverse view matrix. And if you've added any of your own custom functions to set the camera matrix, make sure to update the inverse view matrix in those functions as well. Before moving on, we need to go back to the camera header as I forgot to create a getter function for the inverse view matrix. This will be just like the other getter functions, returning a const reference to the camera inverse view field. Okay, now, in the first app implementation, all there's to do is to set the UBO's inverse view field to the camera's inverse view matrix. And just like last week, since we updated the global UBO definition, we're going to need to update all the shader definitions as well. So open any one of your shader files, add the mat4 inverse view field in the same position as the definition in the frame info header, and then copy the global UBO uniform to your remaining three shaders. Now, as a quick sanity check, if you build and run, everything should still be working as before. Okay, now we can actually get on to implementing the specular lighting model. Head to the simple fragment shader, and by the top of the main function, I'm declaring a new variable with type vec3 called specular light. This will hold the total for each point light's specular contribution. Following that, we will extract the camera's position in world space from the inverse view matrix by indexing into the last column and then selecting the first three components with .xyz. We normalize the camera's position minus the fragment's position to get the surface vector pointing to the viewer. This will be used when calculating the half angle vector. And that's all the pre-calculation shared by each light. Now, per light object, first I'm going to normalize the direction to light vector within the for loop. Make sure to do this after setting the attenuation, otherwise the distance calculation will be incorrect. And then normalizing the view direction is no longer necessary in the angle of incidence calculation. So I'm doing this to avoid having to repeat the normalization function. I believe normalization is a pretty optimized function on modern hardware, but still, it's best not to recalculate unnecessarily. Okay, now let's compute the specular component for the light. The half angle vector is equal to the sum of the direction to light plus the view direction. And we will normalize all of that as well. The Blinn term can then be calculated using the dot product of the surface normal and the half angle. We clamp this value to the 0 to 1 range to ignore cases when the viewer and light are on opposite sides of the surface. And then we raise the result to some power. A higher exponent will be a sharper highlight, and in the future we can pass this value into the shader so that it can differ between objects. Next, we can calculate the specular contribution as the light color times attenuation times the Blinn term. The final step is to add the total specular light to the output color. I haven't included the control term at this point yet since we're not passing it in, so for now at least I'll also just multiply by the fragment color, which, as I mentioned before, is what you would set the control term to in the case of some metallic materials. Now, if you build and run, everything should look much shinier. Also, to check that things are working correctly, is that as you move the camera, the specular light should also move. This is easier to notice when using a sharper highlight. Now, before you go, I just noticed a small mistake. I forgot to multiply by the light's intensity when calculating the specular value. This here should use just the intensity value we calculated above. If I rebuild, the specular reflections are still noticeable, just much dimmer now. Anyway, that's enough for today. Thanks for watching and keep on coding. Cheers.